Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Four men went into a chapel to pray. The first man stood there and prayed with himself. I don't even know what I'm really doing here, because after all, didn't Jesus say that God knows our need before we even ask? Why should I pray? It just seems unnecessary. The second man stood there and he prayed with himself this way. This world is a world governed by hard scientific laws. How and why should I dare to ask God to change any of the rules of this world just to suit my will? That just seems illogical. The third man stood and he prayed with himself like this. It strikes me as being a little bit emotionally unstable, mentally dangerous maybe, to run to God with all my troubles. I mean, I ought to be able to solve them myself. I think prayer is maybe a little unhealthy, a little immature. And the fourth man stood there and just beat on his breast and said, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. So what's the proper prayer? Is it unnecessary? Is it illogical? Is it unhealthy? Or is it the very cry to our God which he commanded us to make? And how do we send that proper prayer off to him? The widow in today's text came to that unjust judge repeatedly, again and again and again. She appealed to him time and again. Why would she just keep at it? I mean, it says that he had no respect for God. He had no respect for people. Here's why. She was persistent. She knew that what was rightly hers, she would get if she just kept asking. She knew there was no way that she could be denied. Now, many of you have children. Some of them are small enough to come up front, and others have left home a long time ago. And all of you were at one time, even if you never had children, you were at one time a child. So sometimes it's profitable to compare what goes on in our human families with what goes on in God's family. Have you ever seen a child ask a parent for something and get no response? Maybe the child thinks the parent just didn't hear, so they ask again, huh? Mom? Or maybe they think that the parent was ignoring them, so they ask again. Or maybe they think that the parent gave them the wrong answer the first time, and if they just thought it over again, they'd come, and so they ask again. And all of you who've had children know we have to put a limit on that at some point, but it's not with the first question always. Sometimes it's with the fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth. Children have some idea of how you ought to relate to somebody that you really trust, somebody that you know they love you. Children tend to say, well, gee, if I just keep asking, they're going to come up with the right answer. Isn't that the way we're supposed to deal with our Heavenly Father? Proper prayer is persistent, and sometimes it's just so persistent that it's continual. You know how it is sometimes when you start your vehicle up, especially if it's a diesel, the first thing, at first you can almost hear every cylinder fire. Goes faster and faster until it's just like a roar, a constant sound, a continual sound. Persistent prayer is like that. Persistent prayer is a life so filled up with prayer that it's just continual. The parable is about persistent prayer, and the first verse tells us that. I'm going to read that again with my own translation. He spoke a parable to them that it is always necessary to pray and not lose heart. Not that we should pray, not that we ought to pray, but the Greek word is we must pray. We have to pray. In the 19th century, there was a famous pastor who was crossing the Atlantic Ocean, and in the 1800s, sometimes that was dicey. Fire broke out in the hold of the ship, and it was a major fire. Everybody was recruited to be part of a bucket line to douse the fire, put it out. As the pastor was passing the buckets, a friend of his said, Pastor, let's go down to the other end of the ship and pray about this. And the pastor answered with advice that was certainly scriptural and also had a lot of common sense. And he said, no, sir, indeed, we'll stand right here and pass the buckets and pray all the time we're doing that. Just like that pastor, we give our full attention to the things of this world. We have to. Sometimes our life depends on it. When you're driving your car, if you don't give your full attention to it, why, you could back up right into another vehicle. Somebody's done that here, I suspect. We give our full attention to it because sometimes our very life depends on it. Have you had those times when you just don't know if you can go on anymore? Maybe you're cleaning the house for company to come over, and you've been dusting and sweeping and vacuuming and mopping, and I wish they just... You have to do it because the day will come when the company arrives. Maybe you work on a quilting group, and you think, I'm just sort of tired of quilting, but the day will come when you bundle up those quilts and you ship them off into the community, into the greater part of the world to help people who aren't as fortunate as you are. The time will come when the job has to be done. Maybe you're like me, prepare a sermon once in a while, and you think, I'm not getting very inspired on this one. But Sunday eventually comes, and it's got to be ready. There's a deadline coming. It's coming soon. God tells us in the 6th chapter of Galatians, let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we'll reap. The snow is going to be coming, and you got to have those last tomatoes picked off the vine and stored, or they're just going to be frozen junk. Sunday's the day for the sermon. The Son of Man is coming back soon to end this world. Don't be mistaken. There is no better way to do good in this world than to talk to your God, asking Him for every spiritual gift and thanking Him for every gift that He's already given you, especially the faith that brings you to hear His word. The Holy Spirit caused Paul to record the same thing. Isn't it wonderful how Scripture says the same thing more than once? It's as if God knows we got to hear it more than once in order for it to sink in. It says the same thing in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. He says, do not grow weary in doing good. Why does God tell us so many times to be persistent in our prayers? Because God knows us. He knows how quick we are to turn away from Him. He knows how quick we are to start relying on our own efforts. He knows that there's an evil seed deep in each of us that wants to grow into mature weeds of disobedience and discontent with God. Conversations with our God call for His cultivation, His plowing up of that evil seed so that the good seed, planted in us by hearing his gospel grows and crowds out the evil seed. The devil never takes a vacation in trying to tempt us away from God. He never says, I've got them so far, they'll never come back. And he's always trying to tempt us away. And neither should our prayer life ever go on vacation from asking God for his sure defense from the devil and all his schemes and his bad plans. David, in psalm after psalm, tells us to call on our God day and night. When we're awake, the last thing before we go to sleep, the first thing when we wake up, and I assume David wants us even to keep thinking and dreaming of God overnight. Paul in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 says it about as briefly as you can say it. He says, pray without ceasing. And both David and Paul, they said those things speaking under the direction of God himself. Proper prayer is persistent. But it's more than that. Proper prayer is confident. I don't know if you've been watching all the stuff going on with the spending battles in Washington. I read in Time yesterday that part of the reason that's now resolved until January, I guess, is because people did deals behind the scene. I'll give you my vote if this happens. And I'll let you throw that provision in if this happens. That's sort of the way the justice of this world works. It's a justice of special interests. I'll give you something, you give me something. I'll give up on this point, you cede on that point. In the parable, the unjust judge didn't respect God. He didn't care that much about what was really right in God's sight or what was really wrong in God's sight. He didn't respect other people. And truthfully, you can't really love and respect other people unless you can love and respect your God. That judge cared only for himself. Now, would you think that you'd always get real justice from a man like that? Probably not. We may not be able to go to people in this world for true justice, but we know where we can go for true justice. We can go to our God because he's a just God. He does the right thing. He never does wrong. He never does evil. He always does right. We can be confident that he will hear us. He will hear our every prayer. He'll hear our every thought. He does what's right. He knows who's right. And now by the Holy Spirit, we know his laws, and we have some clues as to what is right. We know that a just God would have to condemn us under the law because we haven't always done right. But someone's done right. The righteous one of God, our Lord Jesus Christ, did all the right things. All the right things he's done are recorded as if we had done them ourselves. And because we love Jesus and because Jesus loves us and has put his name on us, all the wrong things that we have done, they're not recorded against us. They were recorded against our Lord Jesus Christ, and he paid for them on the cross. So we stand innocent before our God, and we're therefore confident that God's going to hear our prayer. We're his beloved children. Jesus' obedient life and his death and his glorious resurrection guarantee that God loves us and knows us and cares for us and will be with us to the very end. A pastor was visiting the home of his newlywed son and daughter-in-law. Was the first time he'd been there. And he woke up in the morning, and here was this lovely soprano voice singing, Nearer, My God, to Thee. And he just lay there in bed thinking, yeah, my son found the right one. And he was so impressed. So later when he went down to breakfast, he told his daughter-in-law how much he thought of her for doing that. And she said, "Oh, that's just the hymn I do to boil the eggs. It's 3 verses for soft and 5 for hard." Is that confident prayer? No, that's going through the motions. And sometimes we just go through the motions. But our prayer is confident because we live in a marvelous fellowship with our God. He called us out of our past lives of wickedness, and he called us into his presence. We're confident that even when he seemed to put off answering our prayers, he has in fact answered them already. If he seems to put us off, it's because that's his purpose, which he's using in his way to our benefit. Our God is a God that we can approach. We can go right up to our God. We're all the more confident for it. We can just go before him boldly and ask of him. The little child I spoke of earlier in the sermon who keeps on asking is confident. That little girl knows her parents love her. She knows that they'll give her what's best for her. Martin Luther says, that's the way we are to pray. He says, as dear children, ask their dear father. The last verse of that text I read a little bit ago says, he will give them justice speedily. You've heard slow justice is no justice. Just ask a murderer who's been on death row for 10 years if he's received justice. And he won't say that he's received justice. Jesus promises to us that things will be set right, and they'll be set right in a hurry. Promises of someday, sometime, they just don't cut it with us. They just don't cut it. Try making that kind of promise to a creditor who holds your debt, and the debt is due. Someday, sometime, not going to work. Jesus says that he is coming soon, and we can be confident that he's coming soon, and that's why we can be confident when we pray that he's going to answer every one of our prayers, and he's going to answer them soon. The parable has one main point of comparison between something on earth and something in heaven. In this parable, the point of comparison is the unjust judge on earth and the righteous judge in heaven. If even the unjust judge on earth can render the right decision to persistent, confident petitions, how much more will our Father in heaven render the right decision to us when we just keep on praying to him? Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.